And you know what time it is? It's time for KP's video news. KP's video news, y'all. KP's video news, y'all.
That's right, it's time for KP's video news, y'all. I've been kind of spacing it out a little bit here. I was getting a little burnt out, so I was doing like stories daily. So I'm kind of spacing them out here now. But even though I'm spacing them out, I'm still bringing it to you hot. All right. So first story, we got the ballistics in the Breonna Taylor case don't match the Kentucky Attorney General's claim that her boyfriend shot the officer. And the ballistics report from the Kentucky State Police do not match Kentucky Attorney General Daniel Coon Cameron's comments that Breonna Taylor's boyfriend, Kenneth Walker, shot a Louisville officer the night that Taylor was killed in her home, according to reports. The report states that due to limited markings of comparative nature and value, the 9mm bullet that hit Officer Jonathan Mattingly's thigh was neither identified nor eliminated as having been fired from Walker's gun, according to the report. Cameron had told reporters the investigation into Taylor's death ruled out any friendly fire from former Officer Brett Hankinson as a source of the shot that went through Mattingly's thigh and prompted him and Officers Miles Cosgrove to return fire. Cameron had said Hankinson had been eliminated as a shooter because three officers were all carrying 40 caliber handguns, while Walker had a 9mm handgun, the newspaper stated. But last week, Steve Romines, one of Walker's attorneys, said he had obtained a Louisville Metro Police Department record that said Hankinson had also had been issued a 9mm firearm. Though he declined to share the document with Courier-Journal, the ballistics report was first reported and the outlet published screenshots of a portion of the report provided by Walker's attorney, Rob Eggert. Romines also stated on Sunday that the police, state police ballistics report could not determine that Kenny Schott is who hit Officer Mattingly. A Kentucky grand jury last week did not bring charges against the officers in the killing of Taylor, and they announced three lesser counts of wanton endangerment against Hankinson, not directly tied to the fatal shooting of Taylor. Mattingly and Cosgrove fired 6 of 15 shots, respectively. Cameron said Taylor was shot 6 times, though only one of the bullet wounds proved to be fatal. Cameron said Cosgrove fired the fatal shot, but said both Cosgrove and Mattingly were justified in their use of deadly force, Kentucky law, because Walker had fired first. However, with this new information, they don't know. They don't know if that bullet came from the other cop's gun that was in the back of the house firing crazily through the closed windows. Windows that were closed and had curtains. He's shooting through the windows. And in accordance with that, I'm going to do this follow-up here, this particular story here, in reference to that, and it states that Breonna Taylor's black neighbor breaks his silence. It says his apartment was hit too. Maybe I would have been dead too, Stanley David recalled from the shooting. I'm a human being too. And so Breonna Taylor's former neighbor, whose apartment was also hit by the same police gunfire that resulted in a weak indictment of a fired cop, is wondering why the shots that ripped through his home weren't factored in the last week's charges. Former Louisville police officer Brett Hankinson, the lone person being held accountable in the shooting, was charged with 3 counts of wanton endangerment for the bullets that hit a separate apartment that had white people living in it. But Stanley, who was black, was sleeping in his bedroom alongside his young daughter when 3 Louisville officers opened fire while botching the investigation of a suspiciously obtained no-knock warrant. sending bullets flying through his apartment, which is directly above where Taylor lived. David's elderly mother, a child she was babysitting, and that child's father were also in the apartment at the time of the shooting on March 13th. The walls of Breonna Taylor's white neighbor's apartment were more valuable than Breonna's black body, and that's what we're dealing with here. Their lives were also wantonly and recklessly endangered, facts that theoretically should have been considered by the Kentucky Attorney General's office when Daniel Cameron presented their case to a grand jury earlier this month. My apartment was hit too, David stated. The bullet that came through my floor right in front of my bedroom door, if that bullet went through my bed, maybe I would be dead too. I'm a human being too. One bullet went through the hallway floor and another hit outside David's bedroom door. The indictment itself challenges logic. It is based on the premise that Hankerson, along with Sergeant John Mattingly and Detective Miles Cosgrove, all fired their guns a total of 30 times at Taylor's boyfriend, Kenneth Walker, who suspected burglars when he heard someone at the apartment door. When it was forced in off the hinges, Walker got his gun he's legally permitted to own and fired a shot toward the door, hitting Mattingly. Therefore, Cameron said, Mattingly and Cosgrove, Coon Cameron stated that they were justified, blah, 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 blah. And so David, a 47-year-old who was originally from West African country of Liberia, recalled the experience he lived through as being terrible. He said he knew Taylor and refuted the law enforcement narrative that she was knowingly involved in illegal activities. Breonna was nobody like they claim, he said. For as long as I knew her, I didn't see anybody coming there with anything like that. There weren't people coming in and coming out of her house, and it was only her and her boyfriend. David said no one in his apartment heard the police knock or announced themselves at Taylor's apartment, contradicting Cameron's opposite assertion when he defended the grand jury's decision on Wednesday. I don't think that's right, he said, of her death and of the decision not to charge any of the officers in her killing. Breonna was not doing drugs, and she got killed for nothing. She never had a gun. She did not shoot any shots. And that was the neighbor speaking, whose house was shot up by the police, but it was not even mentioned in the grand jury investigation. They only mentioned the white family's house that got shot. Wow. Cameron said last week that one single witness claimed that he or she heard the police announce themselves, but at least a dozen other witnesses interviewed said they didn't hear anything before bullets rang out. And David said the shooting has affected his family's mental health, especially his young daughter. He has problems sleeping at night. He and his family moved from the apartment complex in June. So he did the right thing by moving away from there. But I'm telling you, man, crazy, crazy situation jumping off over there. This is some new information. Got the ballistics. Now you got one of the other neighbors that lived directly above Breonna Taylor's house, whose house got shot through also. But they were concerned about Breonna Taylor's white neighbor that lived next door to Breonna Taylor, which just happened to be white, and the bullets went through their house. So black lives don't matter in Kentucky. And here we go with another story. It's the county, Prince George's County, Maryland, has reached a settlement with the family of William Howard Green, who was handcuffed in a police cruiser when an officer allegedly fatally shot him, the county announced on Monday. Prince George's County has reached a settlement agreement with the Green family, for $20 million. County Executive Angela Alsobrook stated today, and to be clear, there is no price that you can put on the life of a son, a father, uncle, or brother. There is no appropriate price tag to accompany a loss like this, she said. We believe that the actions taken that night against Mr. Green and ultimately taken against his family warrant this settlement. Relatives and family attorney have described Green as a fun-loving, peaceful, and quick to make folks smile. And Police Corporal Michael Owen Jr. stands charged with murder. A grand jury has indicted him, but criminal charges are still pending. Owen also faces manslaughter and weapons charges in the shooting of Green 43 in Temple Hills, Maryland, police stated. And on January 27th, Owen and another officer responded to reports of a car slamming into parked vehicles. Citing a police spokeswoman, the officers found Green, the car's driver, and handcuffed him, believing he was under the influence of a substance. They called for a drug recognition expert and took Green to the front seat of Owen's cruiser to wait. Owen later got into the driver's seat of the police car, and at some point, Green was shot 7 times by the officer's duty weapon. He was pronounced dead at the hospital. There are no circumstances under which this outcome is acceptable, and I want to extend our heartfelt sorrow and sympathies to Green family, stated the police chief. It's unclear what led to the shooting. Video footage of the incident is not available. And unlike some officers in the police department, Owen was not wearing a body camera. And Owen, a 10-year-old veteran of the force, was arrested the next day. And coincidentally, he is a black cop that was arrested for killing a black man. And they settled a $20 million lawsuit with the family. Wow. This is... every day, the hits just keep on coming. I'm telling you now, the hits just keep on coming. So anyway, I'm going to kind of go back to another story. I should have did this one in order with the last story I just did. But anyway, Women's March co-founder Tamika Mallory calls Kentucky Attorney General Daniel Cameron a sellout and tells him she has no respect for your black skin. Tamika Mallory, the co-founder of the Women's March, has harshly criticized Kentucky Attorney General Daniel Cameron, Coon Cameron, comparing him to sellout Negroes who participated in the transatlantic slave trade. Mallory spoke at a press conference in Louisville, Kentucky, where she blasted Cameron over a grand jury's decision not to directly charge officers in Breonna Taylor's killing. Daniel Cameron is no different from the sellout Negroes that sold our people into slavery and helped white men capture our people and abuse them and traffic them, she stated. This is who you are, Daniel Cameron. You are a sellout, and you were used by the system to harm your own mama, your own black mama, she continued. We have no respect for you, no respect for your black skin. All of our skin folk ain't kinfolk, and you do not belong to black people at all. And Cameron is Kentucky's first black attorney general and is considered to be a rising star in the Republican Party. He's also included in Donald Trump's short list of potential Supreme Court nominees and praised by the president, and who claimed he handled the Taylor case very well. Anyway, Mallory pointed out that Cameron announced the grand jury finding on September 23rd, the same date that in 1955, an all-white jury acquitted 2 defendants in the murder of Emmett Till, a black boy that was lynched in Mississippi. Now, I don't know if it's just Daniel Cameron is stupid or that he is very, very, very clear about history and made a decision to wait 6 months and come forward with that announcement, this garbage that we received on the exact same day that Emmett Till's family received the same result, she stated. Spokesperson for Cameron's office said he understands the outcome of the grand jury proceeding was not what protesters had hoped for. And so, you know, hey, she had her opinion. That's Tamika Mallory, calls Kentucky Attorney General Daniel Cameron a sellout and a coon. And let's see here. The one good story. I'm going to do this one good story here. I can't show his picture. Cost guidelines. But this is a 12-year-old. Caleb Anderson, a 12-year-old gifted boy from Georgia, has already finished his first year in college. That's right. Caleb Anderson, 12-year-old gifted boy from Georgia, has already finished his first year in college and has just started his... He is majoring in aerospace engineering at Chattahoochee Technical College. Caleb was just 9 months old when he learned to sign more than 250 words. He eventually learned to speak and read when he turned 11 months old. Aside from the English language, he also learned Spanish, French, and Mandarin. Caleb's parents, Claire and Kobe, knew he was special and has been very supportive of him ever since. As we started to interact with other parents and had other children, then we started to realize how exceptional this experience was because we had no other frame of reference. At age 3, Caleb qualified for Mensa, and he joined at age 5, making him the youngest African-American boy to be accepted at that time. Caleb has exceptional from elementary to middle and high school. His mother said Caleb thought those were boring and not challenging, so he went to college already when he was in, and he was enjoying it so far. He was exactly how I expected it to be if I were like 18 or something, Caleb said. Caleb has two other younger siblings, Aaron and Hannah, who are also gifted. The parents are all proud of them all and encourage other parents to nurture their children's potential. Moreover, Caleb is set to graduate at the age of 14. He will be graduating with a degree. He states that he plans to continue his studies at Georgia Tech as well as MIT. Man, you are another hero of mine, man. 12-year-old kid. And he's in his starting his second year of college already. Caleb! Oh, man, I love it. I love it. Don't let them tell you that lie about you can't do anything. Peace.